In the last lecture, we very briefly went through GWAS studies and how people are looking at either SNP arrays or whole exome sequencing to identify, now recently, whole genome sequencing, to look at a specific nucleotide that associated with the phenotype. So now is, you know, basically, in the early days, people would say, okay, you know, we have a study with that, we find one SNP that gives us a significant p-value, they publish a good paper. In fact, in homework 5, we will ask you to explore the ENCODE. This is kind of a National Institute of Health project to look at regulatory sequences in the genome, and from there, it has the whole GWAS catalog of studies that have significant GWAS. You can see how many significant SNPs they were able to find from each of these studies. It's pretty scary. Anyway, so the question is really how to understand the GWAS. You know, like after you publish early days, you get a paper, now more and more SNPs are being discovered, and also bigger and bigger cohorts are being used. And you can see here just the number of publications related to GWAS, right? So this is 2015 probably. So this number is still continuing to rise. We're finding increasing number of GWAS now, SNPs now. The question is, then what? Because association doesn't really mean causal. If we something to a SNP to be associated with a SNP, nowadays the bar is higher. You have to ask why, what is going on, right? Can we say something more biological about these SNPs? In the early days, you can do a GWAS without knowing any biology. As long as you collect samples, you do the processing, you write your link, you get your paper. Now it's more, you try to understand what's going on. And so the first question they want to identify is kind of related to some biological questions, but also related to the early days when the GWAS SNPs are not as high quality. You might call a lot, they may not be reproducible. And so the question is, what is the most likely causal gene in LD with the genotype the SNP? Because remember, with type the SNPs, it's not necessarily that SNP is important. It could be that this SNP is related to a nearby gene, and you want to see what really is the gene that actually makes sense to the disease you're interested in. And so for this, I want to actually mention one paper about, you know, how do we use public information. This is a work that was actually done by a classmate of mine, Shomo Richaudhary, now at also Harvard faculty. So he is looking at literature information. So this is the list of papers that have been published in the biomedical field. And the red ones are the ones with full text available. So you can search for the content. You can see there are more and more papers published. There's kind of a big resource for knowledge. How can we use it? So he was trying to look at the literature and whether we can use some natural language processing to help with this. In literature search, very often you represent each paper by a bag of words, which means if you have a sentence like this, you'll say, okay, amino acid each appeared twice, analysis appeared once, and so however big this particular dictionary of all the words are, you fill in the number of times a particular word appeared. It's going to be a very, very sparse matrix because most of the papers will not contain most of the words, right? So each document is this bag of words that are counted. And so with this, you can calculate the similarity of two articles based on how many words they share, whether they are correlated. We have two vectors of numbers. Later on, people decided, you know, in addition to just doing a simple correlation, maybe the words should be somehow weighted a little bit. So how do we weight the different terms? There are some terms that are called global weights. For example, a document frequency, which means how many documents have this word in there. So you're just asking, is this word more oftenly appearing in the general vocabulary? For example, a gene probably appears in many, many papers. So the document frequency is very high for gene, whereas progesterone is like a much more specific word. You don't see so many papers with it. And so when you give the word a global weight, it'll be something like this is the total number of documents. PubMed, like whatever, 60 million papers, divided by the document frequency. Is this word appearing everywhere, or is this word appearing only in a subset of papers? So this is in general to the word. Local weight is the weight that is related to how many times this word appeared in this paper. And so that's kind of called the term frequency, which means how many times, like say progesterone appeared 10 times in one paper, but only 3 times in another paper, then probably paper 1 is really more about progesterone than paper 2, right? So that's the term frequency. The more frequent you see this word appearing in this particular paper, the more weight you probably should give it. And so you can also have some weighting on this. Of course, this 10 times, if it appeared in a very, very long paper, like a book, that's not so good. But then if it's a very short half-page thing and this progesterone appeared 3 times, that's very important. So that's also related to the document length. So the less weight for the longer document. Yeah. So you can imagine when we try to calculate the relatedness of papers, this is already done in PubMed. Anytime you look for something on the right side, PubMed tell you related articles in a particular document to this one. So the similarity between the two documents in PubMed was calculated as this. It's the local weight of this term in the first document, the local weight of this same word in the second document times the global weight, and you sum up over everything. Okay, and then you can compute the similarity between every two documents. And this is usually ranked by their relatedness. Okay, so these are all pre-computed. Anytime there's a new paper published based on the text, you will calculate the similarity to all the other published study. And when you go to the paper, you can see this. So how do we really use this for interpreting GWAS? At least for this particular study, they try this. In NCBI, for every gene, you have a whole page of resources, you know, the summary of this gene, the name, like RefC, proteins, and things like that. And it'll have, you know, the pathways related to this gene, and also to a bibliography of papers. See, you can see related, these are actually hand-curated by some people at NCBI who are reading the papers and assign it a term and say, okay, about 3,000 papers in PubMed has this term, at least has this term as a major concept in the paper. Okay, and so based on this, you could calculate actually the relatedness of two genes based on how related their articles are, right? So you can do this because PubMed already calculated the relatedness of papers, and so you can use this correct collection of papers to calculate the relatedness of genes. You can also use, of course, pathways. These are, you know, like gene set enrichment. They're in the same gene ontology or CAG pathway, but you can also use the literature. And so now, after we finish a GWAS study, suppose that you have like 25 regions in the GWAS study. So for example, this is one region. In this region, there are 1, 2, 3 SNPs. This region has a GWAS SNP, but that's significant. But this is kind of a LD block, and within this LD block, there are 3 genes. Like I said before, there are 3 genes that are in LD with your best SNP. And in this GWAS study, let's just say at the end we identify many, many, like say 30 different significant SNPs. And we want to know which genes are the ones that are really relevant. For example, in this region, there are 3 genes. Which is the gene that is really relevant? So in order to do this, you want to see the related genes of another gene to whatever gene we're interested in. And this is by looking at the text, you know, the papers related to this gene, and how similar are the papers on that particular gene. Okay, and so you can calculate the similarity between genes. And so now, when you have a GWAS, okay, say, remember this is the region in the first, so G1 comes from the first region in that GWAS kit. And let's just say region 2 has only one 1, 2, 3 gene, region 4 has all of these other genes, and region 5 has all of the other genes. And remember, region 1 has 3 genes, not just 1. And so what we do is, well, at least in this algorithm, we calculate it. For gene 1, you calculate the similarity of gene 1 with this gene A, and you also calculate gene 1 similarity with this gene, or that gene. And you pick the one that's most similar to this. Okay? And then in region 4, you calculate the similarity of gene 1 with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You also pick the best gene, most similar to it. And then region 5, they're all of this, right? And you pick the best one that you put in here. And you do this for gene 1, gene 2, and gene 3 on the first, on your first region. And that, and you ask which gene on that first region has the most similarity with all the other regions, and that gene might be the one you're interested in. Does that make sense? Because, okay, so, this is one region, this is another region, the third region. So after GWAS, you got to the SNPs, right? And these SNPs are, these are the LD region where the SNP landed, okay? And each of the region has multiple genes. Theoretically, if they are all related to a particular phenotype, like obesity or height or some disease, probably there would be some biological functions that are related to the, all the SNPs on this, to the genes in these SNPs, right? And so, if this one has three genes, and this one has two, and this one has, like, whatever, okay? So different number of genes in each. We are trying to ask, in some sense, if we have to pick one gene from each region, roughly, what would be that gene that would be picked so that all of these regions have the maximum similarity to each other in terms of literature similarity or pathways? Sam?
So the regions that you've chosen, are they like the second best step?
Oh, no. These are all the regions that say in a particular GWAS study, all of these regions meet the 10 to the minus 6 p-value cutoff. These are all the GWAS that you reported to be associated with your phenotype. Whatever GWAS you're doing, as Jay say, you have 30 regions that meet the p-value cutoff, or 20 regions that meet the p-value cutoff. So these are all the regions we reported. Okay? So usually you report an RS, like RS, the particular SNP, but then the region is the block that is in LD with the SNP that you identify to be associated with the disease. Did that answer your question first? So you start, the input of the algorithm is the list of SNPs. Right, the list of SNPs that are significantly associated with the disease. And the algorithm first, I need to identify a block that is in LD with whatever SNPs you identified. And then within that block, there will be different number of genes associated, right? And you want to ask, out of these three genes, which of the genes, in terms of this gene's annotation, bibliography, and pathways, are the most related to all the other regions that are also significant for that disease. Okay? And so it could be you say, you know, for this one, there are three genes. Which one is most significant? It turns out it's this guy, because it's related to this gene, and that gene, and maybe this gene, and this one didn't see anything, or very low, or this it's this gene, and then maybe we'll have genes here, and then it will be that guy. Okay, so if you were to pick this gene, these are the relatedness, you get a score. And if you look at this gene, you're like, oh, there's pretty low, really not much going on, and maybe it's related to this guy, but not much with these, and not much with that. And so you say, okay, probably not the second gene. Right? And the third gene, you ask, okay, what is the most similar one? Okay, okay, it's related to that, related to this, and then nothing, and maybe a little bit to this. Right? And so within it, with this region, you ask out of the three. good similarity to all the other regions that are reported to be significant for that GWAS. Okay? Yeah, so for example, when we try to do this relatedness, so every time you see this curve, this is the whole 23 chromosomes of the human genome. Every time you see a region, so I think these are the SNPs that are significant. And every time you see a line, it's because the genes near that SNPs have some relationship with each other. And if you look at all the curves that are related, it's kind of interesting. You see the words, and you ask, okay, what are those genes? Now you have the collection of genes, and you do like a gene ontology analysis of the genes that are linked to each other, and you see things like histone, hedgehog, bone, cartilage, and growth. And remember, when we started this input, you just give it a list of SNPs. You didn't say what GWAS study is, right? And so in this case, it turns out it's a GWAS study is about height. You know, our height is like inherited. And so at the end, if you after you look at all those genes that are related, you say, okay, these genes are related to bone and cartilage and growth. Okay, kind of makes sense, right? That's kind of an internal validation that this algorithm is giving us something interesting. And so they can also do this for a particular study when there are many GWAS SNPs. You know some of them are going to be wrong, and some of them are probably right. And they ask, you know, out of this study, they initially reported something, and then later on they ask if some other study also did the GWAS and also reported the same phenotype on say some disease or height, right? Which one, the validated ones, are the ones that are repeatedly discovered by multiple studies? It turns out the ones that are validated, in general, this is related to the Crohn's disease. They are in the original study, in the first study, they have the genes that are more linked to all the other regions. Basically, if this region is linked to all the other regions, it's probably a real one. But if this region is kind of an orphan in terms of pathways or literature, it was never known to link to any other gene in that block, in that GWAS study, probably is not real. And so you can see the relatedness of the ones that were validated indeed have much more similarity in terms of biological pathways, whereas other ones that didn't get validated, they have lower scores. Okay? So this is kind of, Yamir.
But there still are some that are validated.
That's true. Could be a new one, or it could be a third study doing this, they can still validate some more. Right? So, and also, this depends on what do people know about the gene. If it's a phenotype nobody studied, then probably we don't know. So it's not guaranteed that, basically, no conventional algorithm will guarantee that you will always get something. And so this will give you some information by leveraging what is available in the literature. And so if people really don't know anything about that, well, then you're out of luck. Right? If you indeed identify a novel gene, you might get it. Okay? Yeah, so this is, yeah, you are able to find, so actually with this approach, they can lower the cutoff. Say, supposedly a GWAS study, initially people are very conservative. They report 10 to the minus 8. The GWAS catalog, I think, is like 10 to the minus 6. But if you are able to figure out which ones are more likely true, then you can even lower the cutoff to 10 to the minus 3, maybe, or 10 to the minus 5, and get more SNPs out. Okay? Peter?
What's the
y-axis? The y-axis is the kind of the p-value of relatedness of this region to all the other regions in terms of their literature support, or pathway support. Okay? Yeah, so that's, sorry, one more question.
I was just wondering, so why can't we calculate similarity between other genes based on like gene ontology tools?
If you only have one gene and another gene, to calculate the gene ontology is just whether they are on the same branch, is that true? So the information for that is usually a little limited. And initially, also, most of the gene ontology was based on just one expert. Whereas using literature, you're depending on the whole world, 60 million papers. Hopefully, that will be more information.